Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the formal part of this meetup. And we have Mike from Cape Town today and Rochelle from Joburg, both in South Africa. And it's a joint meetup as usual with Daniel in Melbourne, and he's got the meetups in Melbourne and Sydney. And we will talk about lots of cool stuff, flight levels, organizational burnout, and how they can help. And also in this call, it's a bit of Kanban and the causal loops. I actually had some really excited people come through when I put the meetup up, because people are really excited about causal loops, and most of them know them in theory, haven't really worked with them. And they're also flight levels is still a thing that seems a bit far away from at least what I can say about New Zealand. And it's actually quite nice combination together with Kanban. Dan, do you want to say a few words as well from Australia?
No, I just wanted to say hello to everyone. And it seems like we've got a real international community on tonight. So welcome to everyone.
Awesome. Thanks. I would say over to you, Mike and Rochelle.
Awesome. Okay, great. So I'm just thinking, Rochelle, we're going to have to quickly put some causal loop stuff in the talk. Are you ready for that?
I was thinking the same thing. Oh, my goodness. No pressure.
Is it not in?
No, it's all good. All good.
Cool. Yeah. Okay, great. So thanks so much, Silke. And like you mentioned, my name is indeed Rochelle, and I am from South Africa, calling in from Johannesburg. But recently, I feel a little bit more like a virtual global traveler of some sorts. So that's really exciting. I'm the co-founder, coach, and trainer from We Do Change. But I see also myself more as a sense-making partner, trying to join people's different journeys and stuff. And my passion is really around creating opportunities and a space for where people can challenge and change their own world for the better. In a world where people wake up inspired and feel like there's trust in the workplace. That's really, really what inspires me. And that's why this topic of today is so close to my heart. And I'm quite excited to have a more in-depth conversation rather than just us sputing our ideas onto you guys. So with that, I'll hand over to my colleague.
Cool. I'm Mike, also a co-founder and coach and trainer at We Do Change. And yeah, I guess, what am I passionate about? I think we're going to find out in the next hour or so. working with a lot of organizations and trying to find better ways to create true business agility, not just have little pockets of agile teams all over the place, but actually make a whole difference to the organization. So I think today we're going to converse a little bit about our current state of misunderstanding of a phenomenon that we've labeled organizational burnout. And it's, you know, it's something that we've been seeing a lot of over our time working in companies. And yeah, so I think we want to explore some of our experiences. So maybe there's some stories and also try and uncover what some of the root causes might be, and how to untangle that kind of web of chaos that often exists in organizations. So yeah, I think that's where we're gonna start. And just a short note: there's a lot of technology happening on my screen, so there might be an occasional glitch or two. But let's see how it goes. And I'm gonna start off by clicking a button, and it's gonna change my screen. And now I'm gonna share that screen because it's all simple, right? And hopefully, you're able to see. Us.
Great.
Does this work?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. Just like magic, right?
You've micified it. Awesome.
of microphones. Okay. So I think just in terms of how we want to proceed, I think if you have questions or comments or insights or anything that you want to share, then please just bomb them in the everyone chat in Zoom, and we'll keep an eye on there, and maybe we'll invite you to join us in the conversation. But yeah, otherwise let's keep it informal and fun.
Okay. So on that note, we want to, before we elaborate a little bit more on what this web of chaos, like Mike mentioned, or rather unpack our current state of misunderstanding of this phenomenon we called, or we've labeled, organizational burnout, we would love to bring in your voices and bring in some of your thinking. And what we're going to do is we're going to put you into different breakout rooms or smaller breakout rooms. And Mike has shared, can you share the next screen, please, Mike?
Yes.
Awesome. So I'm going to move a little bit my head, my small head out of the way there. And in your breakout rooms, we're going to ask you to just have a discussion around either one or more of these questions that speaks to you. Just discuss what do you feel and what kind of resonates with you, what comes to mind. And after the breakout room, we'll provide about 8 minutes in your breakout rooms to discuss this. We're going to bring you back and we're going to ask you to capture your insights, questions, and any new thinking that kind of came out from those breakout sessions into chats. And we might just look at some of those topics in a little bit more detail. So you will have these questions visible in your breakout sessions as well, if Mike is micifying Zoom. So, yeah.
Yes, I will share this slide with you in your breakouts. So, all right, I'm ready to open up the rooms. Everyone clear?
I have a question. Will you, so for the recording, I think it won't record the breakout rooms. Will you have some people in the main room?
We will be in the main room. I think just pause the recording for the breakouts and we can remember to start it again when we come back.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Cool. So in your breakout sessions, off you go.
Where did my people go?
We pulled you back into the main room. It is unfortunate. We tried to do that soft waving, giving you a signal that we're going to pull you back in. But unfortunately, Zoom is quite aggressive with ripping you from one realm to another. So welcome. Okay.
All right. So
what I was actually wondering, so I restarted the recording now after we went into the breakout rooms. If I'm joining the breakout rooms and I'm the one recording, would it record that? Do you know that?
That I do not know. Hmm. You can always try and experiment. I think it'll just record the main room.
Yeah, but on the other hand side, I think it's pretty kind of private talks as well in there. So maybe keep it in the main room.
Keep it in the main room.
So, and let's bring that into the main room right now. So we wanted to just give an opportunity for maybe a smaller group reflection to allow for everyone to get some airtime. But we would love to hear what has been some of the insights or some of your newest thinking around these questions that we've posted. And you can either bomb it down on the chat, or if you're up for it, you can maybe just talk and we can see what are the things that came up.
Sorry, that was supposed to be a raised hand rather than a clap. I think
we'll take
the breakout room that I was in, I think everybody universally had a shared experience that there was noticeable burnout in the workplace. that it was a real problem and that it was creating issues around recruitment, that people were leaving. There's organisational change, all sorts of different factors, the kind of COVID impact. So just people just feeling quite exhausted, lots of change. It's a real problem.
Thank you. Okay, that's good. Definitely a thing. Change fatigue is another phenomenon, right? Yeah. Anyone else? Anyone feeling trapped in their situation?
Well, I can chip in, although I wasn't in the breakout room, I just joined, but reading the topics, I can relate to pretty much my couple of previous roles, definitely. We had experiencing this sort of burnout, but it was probably, the issue around not being empowered enough to make a change and also to take ownership and the follow-up, the organization to follow up on the feedback from the team. So that was causing that burnout as a team. And what we noticed as well, there's a lot more processes put in place, maybe because of this working from home and lockdown and all that. So it was just too much overhead to be able to, attend the real work, which provides outcomes. It was a lot of unnecessary meetings as well, instead of having quick chat. And that led to this burnout, that people were just back-to-back-to-back meetings. And we just noticed that there's not enough time to do work. So that's that, the organization was thinking that, we are going ahead because we have all those meetings. But that was one other side of the story as well.
Great. Thank you. And I think we can all relate in some way or another to lots and lots of meetings, right? Potentially over-synchronization. I see another message from David. One possible cause is people avoiding taking holidays as we're waiting for lockdown to finish. Absolutely, I'm in that boat. Add normal delivery pressure and get a sense of endless pressure and no breaks. It's a thing.
Something we were discussing was maybe not what's different, but what's the same is that individuals and organizations are not always aware they have choice, and that you have this attitude of something hits my desk and I've got to start it straight away, keep starting things, and therefore everyone's working on too much, context switching, et cetera, et cetera. So not being consciously at choice and prioritizing what you start.
Oh, 100%, yeah. I find myself sometimes falling into that same trap of as soon as I get an email or Slack, because everything is now here, right, on my phone or my laptop, as soon as I get pinged here, I go, okay, cool. This is a quick thing, so I can quickly start with it. And at the end of the day, I'm quickly starting with so many things that it feels like I'm going to go insane. So definitely, I see you've got your hand up, Andreas.
Yes, thank you. For me, it is an individual stress reaction. And the stress results from uncertainty, of course, and helplessness is connected to that. I completely agree to you, Steve. We are not reflecting enough about our situation and the resources we have. And then sometimes it's spreading like a wildfire across an organization. Something surprising happens always, and someone sees a negative downside, the risk, freezes, fights, I don't know. All that what is connected to stress levels, and then this thing spreads around.
Yeah, somehow stress is contagious, right? I think often when we're feeling pain, we tend to share our pain with others in order to help ourselves But it causes a knock-on effect for other people, right?
Yeah, we are humans. We are constantly searching for the sable tooth and the risk.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes. When we were talking about it, we mentioned about how we're trying to distinguish organizational burnout from individual burnout. So thinking about how the organization is under stress and sort of stuck and trapped in a particular situation, I think one word that came up was paralyzed. So that it's really sort of paralyzed to inaction, you know, so that they can't actually move and change and improve.
Mm-hmm. You guys, I'm wondering, how are you define organization in this discussion? Because maybe it would be nice to align on this one. I could suggest you my interpretation of this. In this discussion, I think of an organization as a network of people. And if we are talking about individual burnout and organization as a network of potentially burnt out people, so it's an explosive combination, yes, because people under stress, they are not really able to listen, to connect to others. They are very trapped in their own mind and their own feeling of reality. And if you have a network on such people, they're kind of talking not to each other, but kind of, you know, they are not really able to be productive in this conversation they are trapped in. And I was talking about this corner of this this term organization and organizational burnout. Yes. So I think it's about a network of people who are actually don't be able, in this moment, not able to take care of themselves. So
100%. And make
good choices. Yes.
Yes, and we will explore that a little bit more with. We would like to share some stories or how we also came about this conversation. But before we do that, I see, is it Arpad? You also raised your hand. Maybe we'll take you as the last one and then we'll move on.
Yeah, so basically how I perceive this organizational burnout is there are a couple of factors there, but it's basically all on the road to some sort of unordered chaos. So what's happening is that the organizations try to do too much. They try to do too much with not enough capacity, not enough people to do the work. And then they start overcommitting, underperforming, and it leads to a vicious cycle of quality issues, problems, long working hours, basically not completing things. So that's what I see. It's like, you know, from the ordered sequence or delivery cadence, it goes into a chaos when basically the organization is thrashing. So it's trying to do too many things, lots of context switching, and that's what is the organizational burnout, that instead of finishing one project, they're trying to do five in parallel and none of them is finished. And people start leaving because they are overworked, working long hours, and they don't have personal time, they don't have development opportunities, and they can't work on things which are value add. So they are constantly fixing things and running in that circle. So that's what I see, that it goes into a chaotic phase when the organization shows the burnout. So its managers became burned out as well. The leadership lose the traction. They are not focusing on the vision anymore. They're focusing on day-to-day fixing things. So that's the problem with the organization burnout. They don't have the vision anymore.
Totally, totally agree. Of course, I've never seen this happen in real life, right? No, of course I have, which is why the talk. And so really great to hear. Well, maybe it's sad to hear that everyone has some connection with this topic. And I guess what we want to do is try and find ways around or through it. So just maybe some of the symptoms that we've noticed, you know, everyone's 100% busy and it's not enough. It's never enough, right? The business, and I put the business in inverted commas because it seems the business is actually a person somehow. So the business is always lamenting the speed of delivery. It's too slow. And individuals are always waiting on somebody else. You know, I'm stuck. I'm waiting on, right? People are demotivated. Calendars look like an ocean of blue, right? If you're in Outlook, I think often the color is blue. So it's just like this ocean of blue in my calendar, and I don't have any time for real work, right? And massive backlogs, stockpiling needs that are unmet. And then ultimately, then lastly, that interesting one is there's no time for improvement because we're too busy. We've got to get everything done urgently, right? So these are many of the symptoms, and you've mentioned many others. You know, people leaving is a real thing. And that's probably one of the most expensive problems an organization can have, is loss of IP in people's brains, right? And experience in the company. So yeah, so thanks for that conversation. I think, Rochelle, from here, we maybe we should think about, well, what are we actually striving for, right? So
I would definitely, and maybe before we even look at what we're striving for, I'm wondering, Mike, don't you perhaps have like a client that comes to mind, just maybe articulating a little bit more of that pain that we're saying we're feeling, right?
No, sure. So I've been, quite a few come to mind, but one more recently, so a chap, I'll call him Tim, because it's not his name, but let's call him Tim. And Tim's a development manager. And essentially, he personally is looking rather unhealthy and completely burnt out. Like, it's become physical. And, you know, there's this never-ending stream of bad news that he's delivering rather than software. From his development teams, he's delivering a never-ending stream of bad news to the business or the stakeholders, and it's really unhealthy. So his boss actually suggested that he get some coaching, and we've been working together a little bit to try and unpack his scenario and what's going on. And yeah, I think that it's kind of it's never as simple as one person's problem, right? It's always the system that is the problem. And we'll dig into it a little more over time during this chat. I know, Rochelle, you've also got some sort of stories of seeing this in.
Yes. Oh, sorry.
I'm just thinking about your. Are you with us?
Yeah, sorry, it was just a little bit slow. Definitely. So I see Patrick's comments, and we'll get to that first, but we want to kind of just connect on where this came about, or how do we kind of engage with this topic, and how Mike and I looked at exploring what it is that we were facing. And like Mike mentioned now, his client that he was working with, the client that I was working with at the time, we were working with the leadership group, and it was a big organization, and how they reached out to us, or how this engagement kind of came to start, was they wanted us to help fix their agile teams. And with that, I was already like, Okay. Let's first understand what do you mean with fixed. And so maybe, so to give you guys some background on this organization has gone through a big merge, and actually more than one merge of smaller organizations about a year and a half to 2 years prior of us getting into the organization. And a lot of money and energy was spent into making that successful. So they were really, their intent was, we're going to use this opportunity, this punctuation point of merging all of these smaller organizations together, and we're going to agilize it, right? We're going to strive to that goal that's on the screen share. And in actual fact, what it meant is that a lot of smaller consultant companies made a lot of money, right? Because they saw this opportunity to come in and start with training, doing the vanilla Scrum, Kanban, Agile training, and it was very successful. At the end of the day, this organization had amazing, and most of their teams were running and using Agile. Now, with saying that, when we entered, the energy was much different than one would expect the organization to be at, right? It was a little bit different. And because on the one hand, you had these stakeholders, or let's call them business, right? You had business that was very frustrated because they've just gone through spending a lot of money, a lot of time on creating an agile environment, and still little to no improvements were really seen. In actual fact, the speed of delivery and the quality of delivery went down. So that caused a lot of frustration from their hand. And on the other hand, you had individuals and teams running around like headless chickens, trying to cope with the massive demand and constantly needing to change, completely overburdened, demotivated, and frustrated because the promise of change or the promise of agile has done exactly the opposite. It was creating, and what we've observed is it was creating an environment where people were complaining of there was too many meetings. And I mean, you've mentioned it now as well. There were just too many meetings, jumping from one Zoom call to another, from the hour to the hour. There was, no actual time for, like Arpad mentioned, real work, that it had to fall outside of the normal working hours, or what they would call the normal working hours. So it felt like the work-life balance was something of the past. There was lack of visibility of where work is coming from, what is important, because priorities kept shifting, as well as, asking the question of value. What is true value? That was unclear and incoherent across the whole organization. The entity of business, and I'm saying it in inverted commas, business, was starting to mistrust the development teams, because they kept thinking that the development teams aren't necessarily giving them accurate information on committed work or these the everlasting question of when work will be done, and vice versa. The development teams felt like business is just changing their mind. They have no clue of what we actually need to do or what actually is involved in delivering what they need to do. So there was a lot of frustration on both ends, and that is just tip of the iceberg, right?
And so, it never ceases to amaze me how in one organization where hopefully we've all got one goal, or one vision, there's always these two entities, the business and the delivery, and they will fight until the death, right, of the business, hopefully not of each other. And yeah, it just strikes me that if we're trying to get the right stuff done right at the right time, and we're trying to have happy employees, and we're trying to have a sustainable pace, and we're trying to delight our customers, would make sense to me if we were all working together somehow, as opposed to these opposing forces in an organization. So maybe it makes sense to kind of really understand the problem a little better. And one of the ways so there's a tool, and Silke mentioned it at the start, called causal loop diagrams, comes from systems thinking. And we like to use it. In fact, so Rochelle and I sat down and we said, okay, let's try and understand what's going on here, right? So just before I show you what we did, I just want to give you a very rough overview of causal loop diagrams and how they're used. So typically there's some kind of a goal. Like, for instance, we want to increase feature velocity. So in other words, the speed at which we deliver new features, right? So if one thinks about the goal, then an obvious variable in our system is feature velocity. So either it's going up or it's going down or it's going nowhere, right? Another thing, if we start thinking about the feature velocity, is maybe number of defects that we produce, right? So, and of course we're not trying to produce them, but we do inevitably. And there is a relationship between these two things. The more, the higher the feature, the velocity, the higher the number of defects we're going to produce. Debatably, depends on our engineering practices and so on, but I think we can link the two. And then the higher the number of defects, the lower actually the velocity of features, right? So the more defects we have, the lower it is. So this actually needs a little opposite indicator, because it's the higher this is, the lower that is, right? And then if we think about it more, well, the number of developers, because we normally jump to say, if we want more speed, we add more people, right? So the number of developers is going to debatably increase the feature velocity, right? And I say debatably because just throwing 1,000 people at a single problem might not actually speed resolution, right? And of course, we need some cash supply. If we're going to have more developers, then there's more cash needed, right? So we can start seeing that there's a system here. And if we don't have more cash, for example, we can't even talk about more developers, which is often a conversation I hear in organizations, right? But anyway, so this is just to kind of give you a sense of what causal loop diagrams look like at a very, very high level. And then I think we can dive in and go to a bit of a live board where Rochelle and I will take you through a story of our thinking around these clients, right? So I'm just going to click a button and we should be.
Awesome. Okay.
Yay, we're live. Okay. So I'm going to follow you, Rochelle.
Yes.
And take this around.
Like Mike mentioned, this is taking you through what our thinking was, right? So we both shared our environment, some of these behaviors and symptoms that we've observed. And we said, okay, cool, how can we shape the problem? So we started off with looking at, there were some similarities in our environments of a lot of projects that were started and it was in progress or in process, not always making progress, and it wasn't getting finished. It wasn't getting done. And we realized that there is, at least in our environments or in our scenarios, there was a connection or a debatable connection, hence the question mark, with around the amount of projects and the amount of people that had to be pulled in, or the amount of people that had to work and be involved in all of these projects that were started and not completed. When looking at that, we realized that the amount of people that are increasing to work on the projects that were started had a increase in the amount of dependencies between these teams that are working on similar projects in order to to make it to gain some movement. And looking at the dependencies, there were two major symptoms or things that we have observed. And the one was that the number of synchronization meetings had to increase. So we found ourselves in a scenario where people had to jump from one meeting to another just to give a simple status update on what they're doing and where the work is currently in process, because there are so many items that we've started. And there was also effect on the time waiting on others. Because there were so many moving parts, there were a lot of people that were waiting on other individuals and other teams in order for work to move forward.
So, I mean, just thinking about it, the more that we're waiting on other people, if you add up all those waiting times, it's going to ultimately affect the time that it takes to deliver a project, right? So, what happens then? Well, the longer projects take to deliver, the more there's external pressure to deliver those projects, right? Which can start leading towards some really bad behaviors, like an increase in the number of shortcuts that we're taking in order to deliver sooner. And the more shortcuts we take, the more this debt grows, this technical debt grows in, and production defects come in. And the more that happens, the more time we're spending firefighting, right? And the more time we're spending firefighting, the less likely we are that we're ready to take on some new work. So we're starting to see a bit of a thing here, right?
Exactly, mm-hmm. Spot on. And the cycle just continues. And you can just imagine where we're finding ourselves trying to map out this, going into really shaping the problem. And we realize that, you know, the less ready, the readiness there are within to take on new work, the potential for projects not started, the queue for that would increase, right? It is waiting longer because we're not ready to take on more work. And that can, that in the scenario of the what we found ourselves, we realize that that is actually leading to more external pressure for delivery. And the increased pressure for delivery created behavior over some time that, you know, now new work needed to be started because there was this pressure. So just quickly start this one thing again, because we know that other project that we started way back when isn't finished yet. I need this. So I need to solve this for this customer. So the likelihood of a new project started then led us back to the beginning of, okay, now we're again at the start of more projects started than what we actually finished. So, I want to maybe just spend some time or rather ask Mike to just elaborate a little bit more around what was the expression of the pain that we saw, you know, people had in the system.
Yeah, and it's an interesting one because, you know, I think when one enters a system, people will tell you what's going on for them, right? So, for example, these two red ones were prevalent with Tim. He said there's an immense amount of pressure to deliver. And, you know, the problem is our delivery is taking forever. So from a business perspective, if you like, there's a dislike for how long it's taking to deliver. And from a delivery team perspective, there's a dislike for the amount of pressure that's being given. I think we can get ourselves a little lost in listening to the symptoms. And what Rochelle and I did was we kind of zoomed out
Spot on.
What did we see? We saw Elsa.
Exactly. So finally, after spending way too long time, too much time reflecting with one another, we sat back and looked at this amazing picture. And for some reason, don't ask me why, we saw right in front of us was Elsa. And we took her advice. We decided to let it go.
And let what go? I guess let go of, there's someone in front of me standing with an individual complaint about something that's happening to them, right? And it's probably not the, but so while it's important for that person to resolve, it's probably not the problem, right? It's not the root cause. So yes. I think it's,
No, I just wanted to expand on that thought. It's not the root cause. For me, there, it was a little bit of an aha moment, right? And I love working with Mike because I feel like I get those quite often. But with this, you know, picture that we got, and it might also have been because we spent too much time and late at the evening, but we discussed that and kind of unpacked that local optimization is created by your cognitive bias, the result of our brains trying to, you know, simplify the incredibly complex world in which we find ourselves. And a few of you have already mentioned, you know, we as human beings are natural pattern matchers. It is part of our instinct to survive, knowing what is dangerous, what is not. So it's essentially part of our DNA to see what is right in front of us. And taking Elsa's advice of, you know, letting it go takes a lot of mental effort to look beyond, to letting go of the immediate symptom that we're feeling, the pain that we're feeling, and trying to zoom out and to look at the bigger picture. And that's what we want to talk about a little bit more with you today. The techniques we used on forcing ourselves to go against our nature to try and zoom out. And Mike, if you're ready, then I think we can move back into, great. So I would like to talk and bring in Klaus Leopold's flight levels thinking model here. Great. So for those of you who are familiar with flight levels, I'm just going to give a brief explanation of what it is. Flight levels essentially is a thinking model that can help you find out where in your organization you need to do what in order to, you know, achieve the results you want to achieve. So it helps you to position yourself in your organization to kind of help you zoom out so that you're not focused on just the local optimization. And it is based on the example of an airplane taking off. Now, I know with lockdown, maybe not a lot of you are traveling as much, but bear with me. Let's try and imagine, you know, a few years ago when we traveled a little bit more. So imagine you're sitting in an airplane, you've got the window seat, and the pilot said, okay, we're about to take off, and you start on the runway and you look outside of your window, you're going to see a lot of detail moving very fast. And as you know, your stomach turns as you first take off, you'll start seeing bigger objects moving a little bit slower. And these bigger objects might be, you know, buildings to even going to, as big as landscapes moving slower and slower. Past as you're in the air or high, if you've got high altitude. So the same thinking of value and the flow of information in your organizations can be applied. And that is what Klaus refers to as different flight levels. So you've got different information, different pieces of value flowing at a different rate in your organization. He speaks about your flight level one, which is your operational. This is when you're looking outside of the window when you're still on the runway, right? This is very detailed pieces of work, small pieces of work that are moving very fast. This is really around how we are executing. the value in your organization. Flight level two speaks about that end-to-end value generation. So this is a little bit more around what we are working on in our organization and potentially who is working on it. So it's all about coordinating those bigger pieces of value and applying the flight level thinking. It's bigger work and more not as detailed work as what you would have seen in your operational, because we're flying a little bit higher, right? And then finally, you've got your strategy, your flight level three, which is more around the direction of where your organization is heading towards. So this is essentially the why are we working on these initiatives or these pieces or these objectives. What are our direction that we want to get to in our organization? And just something to note that is really important. So just applying that thinking model in where are you in your organization to kind of position yourself. There are these arrows, if you can see, moving back and forth from flight level 3, 2, 1, and vice versa. And that is a very important aspect to this flight level model, right? We need to make sure that it is not just the flow of information, but also the interactions that happen across these flight levels and that it influences one another. So if something happens on flight level one, it should be reflected and communicated and visual on flight level two and three and vice versa in order to allow for the right decisions to be made at the right time.
Mm. So Michelle's just dropped a comment, which I think is quite accurate. So you zoomed out and there was Elsa, which led to the realization that there's no root cause, actually. It's because of the complexity. There are numerous influences. And so it's about the interactions and links between the different flight levels. And I think that's a really great summary, actually.
Yeah. Mm.
So those interactions or those agile interactions represented by the arrows are the thing that actually moves the value, right? And those are the things often that are represented in current organizations as lots of meetings, right? And yeah, so maybe there's a slightly better way. How do we start new conversations, or how do we start addressing the problem? Well, I can tell you what happened with Tim and I. We sat down, and of course he had three development teams and each team had a development board. So what we're really looking at here is, there we go. What we're really looking at here is flight level one, operational level, right? So we've got three boards, and you know, basically we're saying everything here is absolutely chock-a-block. Everyone's frantically busy. I'm starting to lose people, like key people from the team. They're leaving the country, they're leaving the team. And the work coming in is just not slowing down, right? So I thought, okay, well, maybe we should go up a level. How can we abstract all of the tasks and detail that's happening on development? So we started talking about development as a whole, right, all together. So an all development board, and you know, the kinds of items that were on the all development board effectively were projects, right? So a project then gets dealt with, and possibly people from all development teams are working on a single project. Right. So we lose the detail and we're focusing just on projects. And so this is coordination, right? This is flight level two. And then where do projects come from? Well, quite often there's strategic intent, right? So there's a reason why we're working on this project and not on that project. And so we need to be aware that there's some strategy or flight level three sitting above. What Tim and I decided was to start thinking just about this end-to-end delivery system. And where we started was, effectively over here. So in his arena, you know, work arrives from somewhere and it starts getting scoped. And this is already involving team members, right? People that are busy developing the solution. So they're involved in scoping, which is great. Then the items are ready for development. Then they go and do some implementation, they deploy it, they validate it, and then woohoo, it's done, right? Now, the problem was when we took a look at the boards, we discovered there were over 40 projects sitting on this board. You know, and each project is broken down into quite a lot of smaller chunks. And there are only in his group around 30 developers. So over 40 projects, around 30 developers, all, you know, within his scope here. So that was a little scary. So we thought, well, let's focus. How can we focus our efforts to capture the capacity of the development capability, right? So we figured, well, the number of projects delivered over time might be a good way to reflect that. And if we want that to be a valid number, we should probably start implementing some WIP limits on this development process. Now, remembering that these WIP limits are at project level. So these are not user stories or subtasks or anything like this. These are projects that we're limiting the number of. So already if we add these together, it's 2, 4, 6, 8, 11. There's a maximum of 11 projects that can be started, not finished by development, rather than the 40 plus that were already there. And then what we realized was, hold on a second. If we limit this, we are actually downstream of something else, because these things don't magically appear in the scoping column. They come from somewhere. So we took a look at upstream of the development, and, you know, so this is kind of the land of the project office. So ideas come in on the left, and then business cases are produced, and then there's project initiation, then there's some analysis, and then it goes into scoping, right? So there's all this work ahead of ahead of the team. Sorry, how did I come to a WIP of 12 projects? So I think, are you testing my maths, or are you asking about the number itself? Why 12? I'm going to guess why 12.
Sorry, I'm about determinations, kind of. How did you came to capacity of 12?
So
let's say are able to deliver 12. Deliver with a WIP of 12.
Yeah, so it really is a number of factors. So the number of people, the speed at which the delivery rate, the number of projects over time, and then just tweaking until we find the right number that doesn't starve the teams and doesn't overload the team. So it's that Goldilocks zone. It's the just right number. So, you know, whatever you set initially will be completely wrong, and you'll have to adjust it until it gets there.
Did you were in this organization so long that you have the possibility to adjust this WIP limit?
I was
wondering. Okay.
So absolutely. Mm-hmm. And it's something. So by the way, when introducing WIP limits, usually what I do is I say, what is your current WIP? So it's 45 projects. Well, how about we try and pull that down to 35 projects? So we'll flush the queue until we get to 35 projects, and then we'll check, what are the lead times? Has throughput increased? Has lead times decreased? So we'll actually check the measurements, right? And then keep pulling it down and down until we get to a level that's effective. But the thing to understand here is, these were notional WIP limits, right? for the, geez, sorry, just one second. My cat is going berserk.
And also, just to kind of confirm that these were whip limits on flight level 2, so it was actually for multiple development teams, right? Just to kind of
yes. So this is there's 3 development teams in this picture, right? But this was still what we were doing here was still just a conversation, right? So we hadn't changed anything. We were just talking. So we were saying, imagine a space where we had this number of items. If we limited it to this, what would happen? And what would happen is there would be a huge queue growing in front of delivery, right? Because the pace of ideas arriving hasn't changed. So we thought, well, it's time we got the head of projects in the conversation so that we can all agree on if we want to solve the problem and what it's going to take. So we did that, and we decided that, you know, the way to solve this problem is to see the upstream portion of this board as a funnel, right? So the idea is you've got many ideas can come in, but we're only going to work on 4 to 7 of business cases at any given time. We're only going to have a maximum of 3 projects in the initiation phase and a maximum of 2 in the analysis phase. So you can see that it's kind of creating a funnel of items. Now, what gives? Because ideas are still coming in, right? So there's a, and before I go there, we also want to measure the demand. So the demand on the downstream. So the demand on the downstream is the number of items that cross this this line in the middle over time. So how many projects are crossing over into scoping every week or every month, right? That represents demand. And part of the balancing, Elisa, that we were talking about earlier is about trying to match the capacity, which is the number of projects that we're delivering, trying to match the demand to that over time. So it's a constant refinement of and tweaking of the system over time. And then, as I said, what gives in terms of the in terms of the upstream is we've got to get better at discarding things that are not that valuable, right? So we calculated with Tim that any new project that arrived in the downstream delivery area, it would be approximately 9 to 12 months before we'd even look at it. And it's arriving at least 4 times faster than they're leaving the downstream delivery system. So what that means is there are actually projects sitting there that have been sitting there for over a year already. And they've had other projects going and jumping the queue. So it just feels like this dumping ground of of ideas. And the problem is we've actually spent time, the team has spent time scoping those things, even though they haven't touched them for over a year. So it just feels very wasteful. So we've got to get better at early on discarding projects because we know what the capacity is of the delivery system, right? So this is a conversation that's still in progress. And you know, the next step is to look upstream of the upstream. So how do the ideas get onto this board? And they are coming from primarily from the sea level, from the strategy sessions and decisions. You know, we need to onboard you know, a whole bunch of new organizations or new customers, new business partners every month. Well, each of those comes with its own share of bespoke development in order to tweak their product to satisfy the new customer. So each one of those creates a project and so on. So there's a strategic decision that's causing ideas to arrive here in the first place. So one of the things that we've started using is cost of delay, so that we're able to actually place a value over time on each one of the options that's sitting upstream, because they truly are options. We could choose not to do any of them, and we might be out of business in not too long, right? But given that we are able to deliver a certain number of them and convert them into value, a certain number of them every month, then, you know, which ones are the most valuable for us to do? And that's a new conversation that started at the company because of this. Now, what the my favorite part of all of this is, if we are limiting projects, it means that upstream is going to slow down, right? There's going to be less waste. There's going to be slack in the upstream system. And in fact, there is going to be slack in the downstream flight level one systems, the teams. There's going to be slack because there are going to be times when our system is full, but we can't, you know, team A doesn't have anything to do. And that is okay, because at the same time, we're going to be delivering the same throughput or the same delivery rate or better. And therein lies the part of it that's not so obvious, right? Mm-hmm. So the point is, the higher up in the organization that one implements WIP limits, the greater the effect on the entire system. The opposite of that is true. So if I'm a developer in a team and I limit the number of tasks that I perform at one time, it's going to have almost no impact on the delivery system, let alone the company's strategy. So this is how, I guess, flight levels helped to frame the conversation, helped to start onboarding more interested parties so that we can actually get a grasp on the problem. So,
Mike, before we move on, there was just some questions. So if you can maybe go back to the previous, yeah. So there was just some questions that I think let's maybe just take some time to unpack it. And I just want to add on to that. So if you use flight levels thinking to position yourself to understand what it is that we're trying to solve, are we trying to just create focus for in the individual? Are we really trying to solve for organizational burnout? And apply, like Mike mentioned, the WIP limits to that level, it is not just going to help with, you know, how much work is in the system, but it's also going to help us determine what is valuable, what is the right things to work on, and what is the right things for us to invest our energy, money on. And or if we're not investing it in the right thing, it's going to force the key decision makers to make a quick decision and potentially even better decision, right? It's going to enable or rather force a different kind of conversation to happen. So Anthony, I just want to bring in your question. You asked, how much lag time did it take to get the data to understand the effect of the WIP limit change?
So you must understand, so I think there was a confusion. So this the scenario that I'm talking about now, or the story that I was talking about now, is still in progress, right? The point is, we're finding ways to enter and have the conversations that are necessary to improve their system. But what I can say is, on, you know, so outside of this particular scenario, you know, it depends on the size of the system that you're working with and the nature of the work that people are doing. So, you know, the fastest turnaround time I've had on implementing WIP limits, gathering results, and actually seeing change is probably about a month or so. where I worked with an organization of, I mean, they were small. They were like 40 people in total, right? So they were able to move really quickly and make changes really quickly. On the flip side, I've worked with an organization where we were looking at flight level 2. So it was the number of people represented on this kind of a board was about 1,500 people in multiple teams. I can't even think right now how many teams it was. It was a lot. And, you know, we got to a point where we discovered that just strategic projects on the board, there were 125 strategic projects. And then beyond that, there were 700 plus projects that were all due by the end of the month, you know. So it's kind of like, so that's where we started. And, you know, I think the in that system, we were there for 18 months helping with that. The amount of buy-in of the right people is directly also proportionate to how quickly you'll make change, right? And that was a heavily political environment. So sadly, there wasn't a lot of change. You know, we can't win them all.
And it's about understanding what it, you know, you can't win all, but it's understanding what it is that we're trying to solve, right? Or what is it that we're trying to experiment with? There's a few more questions, and there was Silke, thanks for bringing it in. The whip limits on the left-hand side, talking about upstream. So there's a range, right? It's a min and a max. It's more around creating, of course, upstream is all about discovery. And we want to make sure that we work on as many options and we filter through as many options as possible so that, you know, that line, that double line that's represented in the middle there, that Spice Girls moment where you've kind of had the opportunity to ask your customers or your stakeholders or your clients, tell me what you want, what you really, really want. Because once we move it across that line, we're going to focus on getting it delivered. You want to make sure that you don't starve the system. So that's why you typically would have a min and a max on your upstream Kanban, is to make sure that you don't starve, but that you also don't overburden the downstream. So it's more of a range than a dedicated whip limit. Or not a dedicated, but a whip limit, a max whip limit that you would typically find in your downstream. So another question, Dishant, how are the three levels regularly aligned? And if required, quick decisions can be made at the strategy level. You can go, Mike.
So yeah, I mean, I think like any system. So if you think quite simply of a single team, you know, maybe it's the most obvious thing to many of us. So there's a single team. How do we align and make changes? Well, there's a daily stand-up. If we're running Scrum, for example, there's a daily stand-up at which we have some interactions. And you know what? Throughout the day as well, we lean over and say to the other person, hey, I need help, or something like this. So we need similar signals between the systems in flight levels. So if I just go back to this, right? So we need similar signals between those systems. So in the most manual of systems where you've got physical boards representing these things, we have, you know, so Kanban, for example, suggests you create feedback loops explicitly in the form of cadences. So you'll have cadences to review effectively how the work is moving and where it's blocked. You'll have cadence for improvement. How do we improve the system and so on? And so we actually need to set up meetings. And often, for example, the development team people, you might find that there are representatives of each of the development teams going and having a conversation around the all development board. as a stand-up in order to synchronize, in order to expose problems and blockages and to align and focus, right? What is our focus now? And likewise with strategy, although it's probably not daily, depending on where the company's at, but you know, we're working with a client right now and they're having a weekly strategy session. And they're also including some people from the various flight level two systems that they have. So people who are in charge of sales. I don't know why my face is so slow, but anyway, I was born that way, right? So they've got a cross-cutting group of people from strategy and from, let's say, development and sales and customer success. They've got a cross-cutting group of those people that meet once a week, and they actually look at the boards of strategy and flight level two in order to make sure that the right work is moving, and that there's actually we're working on the stuff of strategy as well, right? It's not just random stuff on the development board. I don't know if that answers your question. Quite simply, we need to set up meetings. Yeah,
very similar to a scrum of scrums or scrum of scrums. I get it. Thank you.
Exactly, except that we have a real workflow system as data for the conversation, which is kind of cool. Yeah.
And which is critical to have, right? I mean, we need to understand the picture to engage in that type of conversation. Otherwise, we're going to find ourselves, our natural instinct to kick in, and we're going to talk about symptoms, the pain that we're feeling, rather than looking at, you know, the system in itself. There's a few more questions that have come up as well. I just want to understand, Anthony, if you can maybe clarify, you said, so one project for every two people due immediately.
So when I asked about the size and context, you talked about an organization of 1500 people. They had 700, run of the non-strategic projects that were still essential to do, and they were due at the end of the month. And you had 75 strategic projects that were on the go. And for 1500 people, that's basically one project for every two people due immediately, plus 75 strategic projects on top, which, that's a big smelly work problem right there, right?
Exactly. And it's even worse than that, actually, because they were just one segment and they had dependencies on other similar segments of thousands of people. So it is kind of, you can just imagine. It was incredible that they delivered. They delivered every single month. They delivered stuff, which was amazing to me, given that, right?
That's where the burnout comes from, because it's all heroics then, isn't it?
Exactly.
It is. And it's heroics, and it's management through... the only way that work can get done is that project managers and portfolio managers coerce people into doing work, which of course is not necessarily the best thing for the business, but it's whoever's shouting loudest, right? So it's a very, very big and difficult problem to unwind.
And also very emotional problems that will come up. Sorry, Anthony, I see you wanted to say something as well.
No, I was just saying that, and at a systemic view, you see some of the drivers that sit behind that go, well, how have we set up our incentive or performance system? Are we using OKRs, or are we using MBOs pretending to be OKRs? And without getting into definitions, basically, is there collaborative goal setting, or is it all just or is it all just one way and quite often ignorant of context, right? And so if that happens, then you have to do heroics to do that, and you know, people have school fees to pay and all that sort of stuff. So I kind of get how the pressures play. The dysfunction goes all the way back.
Yep. Totally agree. Exactly. And it's kind of another reason I love the flight level stuff. I mean, each of these boards, of course, we harness all the principles and value that we get from Kanban on the boards, but this is just a thinking model, right? To try and identify where the problem is and where it might originate from, and to expose it in a healthy way so we can have a conversation about the ball and not about the person, basically. So maybe we should just quickly summarize, I think, and then we can answer any more questions, right?
In conclusion, so what I would like to, and I'm, I apologize, my dogs decided that this is now the moment that they need to start barking. So sorry for the background noise. So in conclusion, what we, and I mean, this is now what we've observed in our thinking, right, is that you first need to find ways and find tools that will force you to go beyond your natural instinct of looking at the pain, focusing at that local optimization, because most of the times the symptoms that we're feeling, the pain that we're feeling, is likely not the cause, right? And this was a quite a harsh realization for me, where I sat and realized that, you know, it is possible to be the person who genuinely wants to see that change. We want to improve on that pain that we're feeling, while also being the person whose actions keeps the things the way they are. So by actioning on that local optimization, you're creating you're enabling that system to continue as is, right? To still have that systemic problems. So really understanding that and using different tools to help you position where you're at, and then not going on this journey alone. This is a very difficult journey that we're talking about here, right? This is, I think, Alicia, you mentioned, this is a network of interdependent services and that human system that is kind of entangled into that. So we need to engage people that have a stake in solving the problems that they've seen, right? And understanding what and where those problems need to be solved, and then applying that systems thinking to solving it.
All right, and zoom out. Zoom out, understand the problem scape before you start trying to solve the problem. Really cool, important to do. And as Rochelle said, along with other people, preferably who have a vested interest in solving the problem. Visualize the system of work, understand how value flows through it, where value comes from, where it's going to, which groups or services or things are involved in that flow. And then I think at the heart of this particular case is figure out where or what type of items will give you the most value to limit. So you basically limit the kinds of work items, like projects, for example, where you want to see a delivery improvement.
Yeah.
If I want to see an improvement of delivery of features, then limit the number of features started, not finished.
And before you move on, I feel people that know me will probably think I'm a broken record, but certain things just stick with me, right? So to add on to, and maybe just to kind of summarize it for myself, I always revert back to James Baldwin's quote of, not everything that is faced can change, but nothing can change until it's faced. So the power in having that understanding and agreement around what we're facing will create the opportunity for us to potentially change it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And last, but well, almost last. So try and change the conversation from "why isn't it done?" to "what should we work on the next time there is capacity?" right? That's essentially what we're trying to do. And this will help create sustainable pace and useful conversations. So
be like Alsam. Let it go to let it flow. And that's right. It. Yeah.
Cool. Thank you for that. Thank you for the earworm.
What's that?
We were thinking of playing the song because it was stuck in our heads trying to. Might have not made sense, but it made sense to us at that moment. We could not stop seeing Elsa. So I'm glad, Anthony, we could give you that. Yeah.
I love it.
Cool. Any questions? Yeah.
I think it's also 1 o'clock in Australia and New Zealand, right? So
oh yeah, long time.
Yeah, pretty much.
So nice,
looking forward to that.
Awesome. It's also actually quite it's 7:30 now here, so, and I cannot totally relate to people who actually like to get off their screens because it's long days working from home with their screens. And I really appreciate that everybody, like all of you that have joined today. And there will be the recording available if you want to share it with others, of course. Thanks, Michelle and Mike. This was a really awesome talk. I really liked that we finally got some causal loops covered in a meetup, honestly, and really like making clear how complex our systems are, and that it's mostly actually symptoms we are seeing, and getting this down to the root cause through flight levels, Kanban, and the combination of both. Really awesome. One last chance to ask questions, if you like. Otherwise, I think we will close off here. And if people like to just stay for an informal chat, I'm happy to stay on board for a bit. But first of all, any last questions or comments?
You're also welcome to tell us that we're crazy. It's fine.
We know we are, so it's not going to be new news. At least we're the same kind of crazy that makes it sense, or it makes sense for us to, you know. Mm. And Elsa, obviously, she's definitely involved.
You're both actually a really good team, I must say. I mean, like the interaction was really cool. Like the both of you seem to really know when each other needs to step in to talk.
We do work together a lot, so I think you realize how to dance with one another a little bit better with time. So
I just want to say thank you, and also very inspiring just the questions and comments from everyone else, because thinking back to Aliza's question about what is an organization, and how some comments came up about the system, and the system is the problem, right? So is the organization the system? And when I was seeing that zooming out and seeing Elsa, I mean, often we think the people are the organization or the system, but actually now I'm looking at it as the interactions and the links between the different flight levels are actually the system. And that's exciting, thank you.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thanks, Michelle.
Yeah, mental models for to give us new lenses somehow, and maybe connect a few more dots. I wish I knew everything, but I know very little actually.
We'll never get there.
The irony is, the more you learn, the more you realize you don't know. Yeah.
Exactly, and that's a scary thing, right? Oh my goodness.
Yeah,
constant learning.
Yeah.
And that's why they say oblivion is bliss.
Ignorance is bliss. Because you don't know that you don't know anything.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe that's what I should aspire to.
As we are only just 16 people, a little thing I haven't actually announced yet, and I'm pretty excited about it. We actually secured for February, Mary and Tom Poppendiek for our meetup. And most of us thought they were retired. And I'm really looking forward to these legends because I think they have stories to tell, you know.
I've read their books. And met them. They're amazing folks. Yeah.
Looking forward to that. Yeah.
I was actually thinking about Tom earlier in this talk because, you know, he mentions in, I can't remember which of his books, but news always gets rosier the higher up in an organization it's broadcast, okay. Right?
Can you repeat that? What's the sentence?
News always gets rosier.
Rosier.
The higher up in an organization. So it's like, you know, you start off on the ground and it's kind of like, oh my gosh, the systems are falling over, everything's going to explode. And then it's like one layer up in management, the team's having some difficulties with the systems. And then up into the executive board, it's like, everything's fine, you know.
Oh, yes, I've seen that. Yeah, that's right.
the fact that a bunch of large enterprises have not fallen apart, I don't know how much of it is good luck versus good management. Or whether systems are somewhat self-correcting, even though they burned through people in the process.
Yeah. Yeah, I think there's a large wake of burned people in the background. The exhaust pipe of the organization, right?
Yes.
And that's why it's so frustrating for me, because that's the cost, right? The cost of us not having the right conversations are human beings that are suffering, right? And in work environments that's causing more stress than what is needed and more burnt out and frustration and mistrust. And those are all behaviors that we don't want to see, right? Well, I don't want to see that. I want to actually really believe that we can get to a point where there's trust in the and safety in at your workplace. And it's not this thing of, oh my gosh, another meeting, or this person won't trust if I say this, so I need to use this to cover my back. I can't survive with the thinking that is our future. Mm. We need to change. And that's why it is so important to change our conversations.
Mm. I have this mantra that I really say often. I believe that people go to work to do a good job. And like Patrick said before in the chat, mostly people, if they are perceived as not doing a good job, is often just really the system, and they don't know how to change the system so that they can be good at what they're doing. But I'm a deep believer of that, and I most of the time I see people, and when I say that and they agree, but I did actually have the experience when people disagreed with me, managers, where they said, I don't think that's true. And that's, that tells you something about the organization. Well,
it's interesting. So what in their experience did they tell you led them to believe that people don't come to work to do a good job?
I don't know. Yeah.
It doesn't matter. Why aren't people asking why?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why is that person not doing a good job? What do we need to alter so that they can do their best? Nobody's caring about the people and nobody's asking why.
I had a manager respond once. Remember the retrospective prime directive? It's along those lines of what Silke just mentioned. And I had a fairly senior manager respond to that by, wow, that's a big mindset shift. And it's like, whoa.
Welcome to the world.
Shocking. Yeah. Yeah, it was always looking, that particular manager was always looking to, for someone to blame and burn, and you can imagine what sort of culture resulted from that.
I did have someone fundamentally object to the prime directive and say, I honestly don't believe it's true, and I refuse to say that it's true.
Yeah.
And they couldn't.
Yeah.
Well, we had to go ahead without them because they couldn't partake in making the space safe.
Yeah. I mean, I heard a friend of mine has this saying, and he says, you know, companies that are trying to get rid of the dead wood, you know, that they refer to, you know, let's get rid of the dead wood or the driftwood from our organization. I say to them, so you hired, so either you hired dead wood or you hired live wood and killed it. Right?
That's good.
You know, so either way, either way, it's your fault. So do something about it. Don't fire them. Yeah.
And typically when you start having those conversations of do something about it, then it's not aimed at creating different experiences for people, right? And then, so if you bring in the results pyramid around really how people's belief or what kind of drives their actions are their beliefs, and their beliefs are kind of created by the experiences that they have. Mm-hmm. So either a conversation or someone is giving lip service and acting in a different way. Those are the experiences, right? The stories, the culture that we talk about. And a lot of the times we're dealing, well, I've dealt with leadership where they, once again, they really genuinely want to maybe change things, but they don't know how to, and their actions are reinforcing the bad experiences. So they're managing more than actually leading. So they just then go, okay, great, let's create a process that's going to help them, or let's create use this tool because it's going to help them, because I genuinely want to see improvement. But it's then we need to make them see that it's not about that process, because that's managing. We need to enforce a different experience. They need to create a different experience for the people to, in order to create different beliefs that will then adhere, or then will, you know, have that infliction point of a different action, a different behavior that will be manifested. So it's such an entangled, because we're human beings are complicated, right? Oh, and complex, and just it's just chaotic because we've got different mental models and different experiences. So yeah, it's, I think a lot of the time management and leadership also don't know, and they think by managing or creating new processes and bringing in new tools, or and even bringing in agile, right, this is a tool and things that they think, okay, gonna change the organization, but it's not creating new experiences. So it's difficult.
Mm. Pip almost started crying as you were talking, Rochelle.
I hear it every day. We'll just make a process. Let's make a process. And yeah.
Let's add another one without paying attention to the art of simplicity. Because that's the really thing is simplicity done well is really, really, really hard. It's very easy to add complexity, but that's what kind of the problem that we've got. So, solving complexity by adding more complexity doesn't really solve that. So, you know, it was that. And Mike, in your reference to Taylorism, I recently learned at another meetup, someone who studied basically the story of Frederick Winslow Taylor, not just his thing on scientific management, but he consulted to a bunch of companies. So he established a school at one of the first university schools of management, which is why it became, that thinking became so prolific. But each company he went and consulted to in his day, he basically kicked off serious industrial unrest because everywhere he went, he pissed off the entire workforce and there were general strikes and all sorts of stuff. Right. So, you know, there's a good question. I mean, the 1930s were pretty tough anyway for a lot of people, but there's a question around, you know, how much did he contribute to the development of the kinds of movements that brought on World War II?
Mm. Yeah. And it was also a different world back then, right? A lot of the problems that were being solved were industrial problems. You know, which had a more of an engineering type approach where we're dealing with physics and we're dealing with tangibles. In the knowledge work now, there isn't one right solution. So,
yeah,
you know, so carrots and sticks, they don't, they work opposite to how we think for knowledge work.
I think we agree on a lot. you know what? If we had solved it all, none of us would have jobs. But
yep,
true.
Yeah, and I still don't think we're going to solve it all, right?
Yeah.
But we can try.
We can try. Look, there's always opportunities to make improvements, and like I say, really appreciate the work you guys are doing.
Mm-hmm. Cool, thank you.
Yeah, it was excellent. Yeah, thank you. It was really a good discussion, good eye opener. I like the model. It's really
and in light of that, where I live, my city has a public holiday off tomorrow, so we're all gonna take it. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
You'd be surprised. Excellent. This is for a football final. That's why we have a public holiday.
I like it even more.
That's doing it right.
Yep. One of our public holidays is for a football final. One of our other state public holidays is for a horse race. So we've kind of got it.
I think those are the right holidays anyway. So that's good.
Right.
No. Folks, maybe this is a good moment to wrap up the recording at least. So thanks everybody who's been here. Stay online if you like, but I'll stop the recording now. Thanks, everybody, and see you next time.
Thank you all
for recording.
Theodora and about Kanban for project management. See you then.
Thank you.